our president, the president of the University of Maryland, Wallace Lowe. Wallace?
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to this incredible celebration. This is a celebration of the people who are in this room and the families of those who pioneered the experimental efforts that led to this detection. They pioneered it 50 years ago. And above all, it's a celebration of the human spirit, of an incredible scientific achievement. So, as I was thinking about some brief remarks, I was in fact expected to be giving a keynote address in China right this moment, but it got canceled, so Giant asked me to come here instead. But we as humans, ever since we started walking on this earth, have been gazing at the heavens. And it wasn't until about the 1600s when Galileo started viewing the heavens in a scientific way with his telescope. And over the years, more sophisticated instruments have been developed to uncover the mysteries of the cosmos. And for me as a layperson, it is simply astonishing. It's absolutely incredible that in September and December of last year, many, many people who are in this room and hundreds more or thousands more around this globe, scientists, engineers, students, faculty members, had a role in detecting for just fractions of a second a collision that occurred over 1 billion years away. This is simply, absolutely, as young people like to say these days, awesome. So, what we're honoring today by this celebration are true visionaries. Many, many people, but I have to acknowledge one pioneer from the University of Maryland, the late Professor Joseph Weber. His family, his entire family, generations of his family are here this evening. Thank you for coming to this celebration. Let me just conclude. Thank you all for what you do for science. Thank you for being here at this celebration at the University of Maryland. Thank you for opening a new window to our universe.
It's my pleasure to welcome all of you once again, and especially our distinguished panelists, to our celebration of gravitational waves. We have over 100 alumni in the audience tonight, including some who have traveled from as far away as California and Oklahoma. Tonight's celebration has been a half century in the making, with its beginnings traced back to this campus and specifically to the physics lab of the late Joe Weber. Joe was a true pioneer. He launched the first concerted effort to detect gravitational waves, which had only been predicted to exist by Albert Einstein's theory of general relativity. While we are sad that Joe did not live to see this year's developments in the field, we are delighted, as Wallace said, that Joe's family, including his children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren, and especially his wife, Virginia Trimble, are here in the audience with us tonight to celebrate. Joe's dedication to the search for gravitational waves helped the University of Maryland create a vibrant gravitational research group that carries on to this very day. Over the years, that group has included faculty members like Charlie Misner, who is on the stage tonight, Jean-Paul Richard, Dieter Brill, Ho-Jung Paik, Ted Jacobson, Baylor Koo, Peter Sean, who is also on the stage tonight, and Alessandra Bonanno, who is also on the stage tonight, and many more. And these faculty members have served as advisors and mentors to TERP alumni who have also made a huge impact on the field, including Richard Isaacson, Robert Forward, Richard Matzner, Bev Berger, and someone very close to me, my uncle, Vishu, C.V. Vishweshwara, and many more. Our campus has been buzzing with excitement about gravitational waves since February, when the National Science Foundation and the LIGO Scientific Collaboration announced they would host a press conference to discuss the effort's latest progress. I joined more than 200 faculty and staff members and students who packed the lobby of our physical sciences complex to watch the press conference live. And this is what we saw and heard.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have detected gravitational waves. We did it.
The crowd in the lobby cheered with excitement. Another cheer broke out later on in the press conference when one of our speakers tonight, Kip Thorne, called our own Joe Weber a pioneer in the search for gravitational waves. And then this group of over 1,000 scientists did it again. They announced in June that they had detected gravitational waves in a second event. We are so proud of the legacy that University of Maryland researchers and alumni have created in the field of gravitational waves, and this year's discoveries give way to the age of gravitational wave astronomy. We know that TERPs will continue to lead the way in the future with new technical innovations and theoretical insights. At this point, I will turn things over to Dr. Sylvester James Gates Jr., our Master of Ceremonies for tonight's panel discussion. Jim has been a member of the physics faculty here since 1984. Most recently, he was named a University System of Maryland Regents Professor. Jim serves on the US President's Council of Advisors on Science and Technology, and in 2013, he received the National Medal of Science from President Obama. He is also a member of the National Academy of Sciences and the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. Ladies and gentlemen, Jim Gates.
Thank you, Giant, and thank you for those kind words. Good afternoon and welcome. My name is Jim Gates, and contrary to what some of you might think, I do not just pretend to be a physicist in TurboTax commercials. I also pretend to be a physicist in real life. Well, actually, I am one, even if the Maryland Governor's Office doesn't know that. I love to talk about science, and certainly my own, but today and tonight, I'm going to be just your guide to talk about science that I don't do, but science that has been done by a modern group of scientific heroes and heroines. You'll notice I have on a dark suit. This is what I call my suit of whimsy. I only wear this when I'm about to have a lot of fun and whimsy, so that's supposed to be the spirit of this celebration tonight. So, I'm going to introduce our panel. On the stage, we have five very distinguished physicists. Kip Thorne is the Feynman Professor of Theoretical Physics Emeritus at Caltech. Alessandro Bonanno is a University of Maryland College Park Professor of Physics and Director at the Max Planck Institute for Gravitational Physics in Potsdam, Germany. Charlie Meisner is a Professor Emeritus of the Physics Department here at the University of Maryland. And Peter Shawn is an Associate Professor of Physics here. And then finally, at the far end, we have Ray Weiss, a Professor Emeritus of Physics at MIT. Peter and Alessandro, as LIGO principal investigators, lead research groups at their respective institutions and played important roles in the data analysis and waveform modeling for the recent discoveries of gravitational waves. Kip and Ray are revered as the co-founders of LIGO, They, along with Ronald Drever of Caltech, have received four major prizes this year for their contributions to the direct detection of gravitational waves. These prizes include a special breakthrough prize in fundamental physics, the Guber Prize in cosmology, the Shaw Prize, and the Kavli Prize in astrophysics. And while we're here today to celebrate the first and the second direct detections of gravitational waves, we're also here to honor the role that University of Maryland pioneers played in this process. Charlie has been thinking about black holes and gravitational waves for a long time, since he and Joe Weber spent a semester together at Leiden in 1956 together with John Wheeler and began incubating ideas about how to detect them. We are honored to have such gifted scientists here among us tonight. So I think let's give them all a round of applause. Now, the idea of a wave of gravity is so strange that even Albert Einstein had a difficult time wrapping his mind around it. So let's review a little bit of history. It turns out that his equations describing gravity first were concluded in the period 1915-1916. And he actually talked about waves in 1916, but the work contained errors. A 1918 paper corrected the earlier errors. They were about the size of the waves, what we call the amplitude. And it also, this later paper in 18, identified what we physicists call quadrupole sources for the radiation. In a 1936 submission to Physics Review, together with another physicist named Rosen, he used what we call a bad coordinate system and concluded or proved that the gravitational waves do not exist. Now, it was only a submission. The paper was never published because a referee found the errors. But nonetheless, the fact that the journal had required a referee to look at Einstein's paper was such that Einstein never submitted another paper to that journal. A corrected version of that paper was published elsewhere in 1937. So that gives you a little bit how hard it was for Einstein to think about this idea. So since most of us don't have these like Einstein apps running between our ears, I thought that we would approach this by first starting with something that's really simple, namely science fiction, and then we're going to bring it to the reality that our colleagues here will discuss for us tonight. So let me ask for the first clip, SunGrav, to start running. So imagine that an alien species could make our sun disappear. I mean, that's a science fiction idea, but let's do it. And here in the image we see, the sun is gone. And wait, there's this wave that you see coming out from the sun like a tsunami. But in this picture, this is a gravitational tsunami. Now, of course, in real life, you cannot get that to happen. So let's come a little bit closer to reality. And for this, what I'd like to do is to cue up our second image called Bistar. And so here's an image of what looked like two basketballs, perhaps on the surface of a pond. But these are really supposed to be representations of neutron stars. Neutron stars are created when stars that are about between 10 and 30 times the mass of our sun collapse, and they form these very dense objects that have the density of neutrons. They have very powerful magnetic fields, which you can see as the striations around these balls. And at their north and south magnetic poles, they shoot out beams of accelerated particles. And that's, in fact, how we first detected these objects. Now, if we can cue up the second film, we've been watching these neutron stars. So let's imagine traveling out in space. And here we come down from the North Pole. We see the neutron stars with their beams flashing at us. And then we're going to go take the same perspective that we just took a second ago. And you see that stuff that looks like water? That's not water. That's space-time. The theory of gravitation, which Einstein gave us, tells us that space-time is like a thing. It's like a substance. And just like a substance can be made to be pushed out of the way of a material body, space and time are pushed out of the way of these very dense neutron stars. But wait, we're going to go for a journey. Here we're in the interior region. These waves of gravity are kind of like waves that perhaps the Silver Surfer could take. So let's surf one of these things through space. And we'll, as you look through them, you can see they distort the starlight. And then as they approach our planet Earth, and that's in fact the illusion that was made in the introductory remarks about the heroic work that has been done by this, that this is what happened. And as we pass the moon and break through the clouds above the state of Florida, we're going to find a facility, the Hanford Reservation facility, that is the portrait that these folks have given us, and there it is. So that's gravity waves in science fiction. This hasn't happened yet, because these gravity waves have been generated in this animation by neutron stars, and many of us thought that would be the first message that Kip and Ray would tell us, that they had gotten messages from neutron stars, but Mother Nature had a great surprise, and in fact, it didn't happen that way. So now we're going to go to the real experts and talk about what really happened at LIGO. Charlie, can you tell us a little more about why we are celebrating today?
Okay, very happy to. There were two great accomplishments announced at this press conference you saw a clip from. One was the detection of gravitational waves directly. They'd been inferred from other things before. And the second was the discovery that nature actually contained a binary black hole. So we, from this result, got an understanding that there out in nature, a billion light years ago, far away, two black holes danced around each other, merged, and as a side effect, sent off this gravitational wave, which eventually tickled the detectors that you will hear more about. So the next thing I would like to see is how do we, I want to tell you that these black holes, which I'll concentrate on, consist of nothing but empty space. There's nothing there except, in Einstein's language, curved empty space. Now, what do we mean by curved empty space? Well, I have this cartoon here to show you that we could at least notice that we're looking at a curved mirror instead of a flat one by the distortions it produces. The image, the light that comes from our body reflects from the mirror, comes out looking different than what we know the real object was. So a curved mirror can produce distortions in the images that you see from it. We're going to detect the curvature of space-time by looking past the black holes to something behind them. So the next slide, I think, will show what we want to have behind them. That's too far. I want the one before that. That's it. We want that. And this is a picture of a piece of the Milky Way that a marvelous, talented group called the SXS group, Caltech and Cornell primarily. And this is a bit of the Milky Way. And in our minds, we've got a video camera looking out towards this direction of the Milky Way. And then we hire our pair of black holes to come and perform on this stage for us. So we're going to put them between that piece on the Milky Way and us, and there they are. And as you see, it's completely distorted picture of the Milky Way. And in fact, you might see that before, where there was one bright spot here, there's a second one. Light came to us two different ways. There wasn't just this one piece with a few bright stars. If we go to the next one, that shows up twice, here and there, and also the bright stars once here, and the same thing's there. The light from those stars had come through the curved space-time and got bent around until it came to us from two different directions. And that is the argument that the space-time in between must have been curved, since we have reason to believe that there was absolutely nothing there except empty space in this curved state. Now we'll go on and see that thing in motion so that we can see, because this is what produced our wave. Back in the corner here where nothing much happens, you'll see little bits of motion. That's beginnings of the waves that will eventually come out to us. But mostly we're looking at the action as these two black holes go around each other, and all we're seeing is what happens to the light that passes near all this from the distant Milky Way bit. But they're merged, stopped, not much happening. So there's a credit line for these very clever people who produced it. And now the question is, we are really convinced that there were these black holes that did their dance and produced gravitational waves. Well, the apparatus we'll hear about later detected these gravitational waves, which got very weak as they spread over the whole distances of the universe. So we'll go to the next slide and see what was actually detected. And there, you see, there are these bits of data. They're just electrical signals that were generated by mirrors moving in these interferometers. Those electrical signals are plotted, and they're very much the same at the two places. And in addition, this slide that's easiest to see in the top one, where there's a smooth, more yellow curve, that was a curve calculated from Einstein's equations as to what two emerging black holes ought to produce in waves. And the other more jagged part with a little bit of noise in it is what they actually detected. Same thing at Livingston. The two of them saw the same thing, which convinces us that there was something really going on. It wasn't just mistakes at one of the two places. And so that's the data on which we based our belief that those first pictures showed something real in the universe. Now, it may seem strange to take from apparently a little bit of data, although there are actually a lot, a conclusion about major things happening in the universe. But science has been with that for a long time. We go back to the Danish astronomer Tycho Brahe, and he made such careful measurements of the appearance of Mars in the sky and recorded it in his notebooks that Kepler and then later Galileo and Newton were able to deduce from these lists of a few positions of Mars and not a few hundred of the sky, the picture of the solar system that every one of you can produce in your heads right now if you just want to. Think about the solar system, sun in the middle, the planets going around and so forth. That whole picture, we never sent a camera up to take a picture of the solar system from far away, because the solar system, it takes about about 10 minutes, about 10 hours for light to get from one end of the solar system to the other. You'd have to go 10 light hours away to get your camera pointed down to take a picture of the whole thing. And that's if the camera could get up there in speed of light, it would take 10 years. But since things go much slowly, it might take 1,000 years. So we haven't done it, but everyone has that picture based on a few bits of data in Tycho Brahe's books and the interpretation and the additional data that came from them. So that's what we, here is the kind of data we're getting, but I think in each of these pulses, you would find not a few hundred points, but maybe 10,000 individual points. There's a lot more data here than Tycho Brahe had, or even Newton had. So the next slide translates this electrical signal into a sound. Why? Because okay, we'll stop that for a minute. Why do we do that? It's because those wiggles are going on at 100 to 300 oscillations per second. Our eyes can't follow that. If you look at a hummingbird, its wings are totally blurred because they're going faster than 100 cycles a second, and your eye can't follow it. But our ears can hear the hummingbird, and so our ears are more sensitive to some of those frequencies. And so even before this discovery, some of the scientists in the group had put together a way of looking at this kind of data so that it would make more sensory sense to us, and they translated it into sound, and you see that what looks electrically like a bunch of wiggles going up, if you plot frequency against time, in notice only a fraction of a second, the frequency goes down and it gets louder and faster. It's as though a cellist had struck a string and then slid his finger down the fingerboard so the tone went higher and higher and higher and then stopped. So that's the picture. The question for the others is, how did we get little pictures of data like this? A, how did we get them? And secondly, how did we get from those pictures to the idea that they're telling us that whole picture we saw at the beginning of two black holes dancing around each other in Kolesi.
Thank you, Charlie. And I just wanted to add that notice that mathematics plays a role in this, because in fact, Charlie said we have the data, and then you have the interpretation from Newton. In our society, people often don't appreciate what mathematics does for us. And without it, we couldn't translate these signals into a coherent view of the universe. Charlie, now that you've talked a bit about recent discoveries, can you take us back to the 1950s? What was the prevailing sentiment surrounding the possibility of detecting gravitational waves at that time?
Okay, well, I'll talk about how difficult it was to get in the business at that time. And we'll turn later about who and what did it. But back then, it was not popular. I was a student at Princeton with John Wheeler, and he was interested in this. Bob Dickey there was trying to think of experiments, but the faculty could not be convinced that this was the future of physics. And as a result, even after I spent almost 10 years there and rose to be an assistant professor, they let me know that at Princeton, we are not going to invest our tenure slots in gravity. It's a dead end. Please, we'll keep you for a few years, have fun, but then it's finished. So I ended up coming to Maryland. It turned out to be great. It was great because Joe Weber was here already trying to look at gravitational waves, and we will hear from Kip sometime about his advice from Caltech and his friend Novikov's advice in Moscow, how all of them were told, watch out, don't get into gravity, it's a dead end, please find some real physics to do.
I attest that's true. I was told the same thing.
So I have to tell you, Charlie, of course, that that story of yours has been repeated more than a few times since, where very esteemed and famous institutions tell a young professor that they know best. And in the end, it's the young, and this is a message for the young people, too. Young people generally can see farther, and they're the ones who make the innovation happen. So don't be afraid to trust your instincts. Charlie, how did you first meet Joe Weber? And so what was that like when you first met Joe?
Well, the beginnings of it was as a graduate student, I was working with John Wheeler, who I chose for my advisor over another man I'd worked with because Wheeler was full of enthusiasm. He pointed out to his student, Feynman, that Feynman had written a thesis within a year or two, and it was only 50 pages long. And the other professor said, well, he felt that it was for honesty, he had to point out to me before I signed on with him that his most recent student had spent 7 years, and his thesis was 1,000 pages in two volumes. And so Wheeler was much more attractive, and also he was doing all these geometric things that I had some background in. So I signed up with Wheeler, and the next year he took me with him when he was invited to the university at Leiden as a visiting professor for one semester. He took me along. Joe Weber was on a sabbatical from his engineering job here because he wanted to learn more physics and do gravity. He was there with Wheeler, and there was one other very clever student there. So we spent 3 or 4 months in the spring in Leiden, Holland, talking about nothing, at least in that room, except gravity. Wheeler had another room he could use to do his nuclear physics, which he was trying to finish up with. And Joe Weber was worrying about gravitational waves and was preparing to write a paper on the questions of are gravitational waves really implied by Einstein's theory, which people argued about for a while, but not much longer than that. So that was the beginning stage.
Okay. Kip, you had a personal relationship with Joe. In the early days, what did the two of you talk about? And let me make this a two-parter. Did you share Joe's convictions regarding the possibility of finding gravitational waves? And if you didn't, did you need some further convincing?
So, Charlie, I think you were in Leiden with Joe and Johnny, 57?
56, right? Yes.
56, okay. So I come on the scene 6 years later, 1962. I arrived at Princeton as a first-year graduate student. By then, Joe had designed and was building his first gravitational wave detector. So this is a little bit later. The foundations for his experimental work were all laid, and he was off and running. In the summer of 1963, I met Joe during that year when he visited Caltech a few times briefly, but I really became closely acquainted with him in summer of 1963. There was a summer school, an idyllic location, Les Ouches, France, high in the French Alps, near the resort of Chamonix. And Joe gave a series of lectures about gravitational waves, both the theory from his experimental point of view and the experimental approach he was taking to try to detect gravitational waves. That same summer, this summer school lasted for about 8 weeks. It was a long summer school. I think Joe was there with us for 2 or 3 weeks. At the same summer school, John Wheeler talked about gravitational waves from a geometric point of view, and a guy named Ray Sachs talked about it from a highly mathematical point of view. So we had three points of view, a very physical point of view from Joe, geometric from Wheeler, and mathematical from Sachs. I became enamored and hooked, and I particularly was hooked by Joe. Joe and I went hiking in the Alps for a full day several times during during that time. And we talked further about his experimental ideas and about gravitational waves more generally. I felt enormous enthusiasm for the directions he was taking this field. Nobody previously had had the courage to even think seriously about going after gravitational waves. As Ray Weiss may tell you, often points out, Einstein himself said, in effect, that these are never going to be detected because they're much too weak. But Joe, as a result of, well, both his ingenuity and his insights and our improved understanding of the universe, so we understood there were some possible sources there that Einstein hadn't known about, and the new technologies that were available by then, Joe had the courage and he pioneered the field, and I was enamored. And so naturally, when I went back to Caltech, I'd been an undergraduate there, I returned on the faculty in 1966, I built a theory research group that was working in black holes, neutron stars, and gravitational waves, and focusing on the theory of gravitational waves and on sources of gravitational waves. I watched Joe's experiments with great enthusiasm, and I found it quite plausible that he would succeed, but I did not look deeply enough into the technology of the experiments to have any really full understanding of the odds of success. I ultimately did do that in the mid-1970s, but at that era, I shared his enthusiasm. I appreciated the direction he went. I went back and looked at a referee report I wrote about one of his proposals in 1970, just yesterday. And my level of enthusiasm was just effusive in that referee report. I said, I think I understand Joe's experiment better than any theorist does, but I underlined theorist. And I visited him in his lab a number of times in the late 1960s and the early 1970s. I was just plain enthusiastic.
Great. Okay. Ray, Joe Weber thought resonant bar detectors were going to be the best method for detecting gravity waves, and he wasn't the only one, was he?
Right. Well, I'd like to say something about Joe with the other
right
slide.
Ahead.
Can we go back a slide for a second? Okay, let me just make sure the audience realizes what they're looking at. That's Joe, of course, but look here. There is one of his detectors. That's Weber's bar. And behind it is a set of little sensors that measure the motion of the bar. And the idea was that he had, which was ingenious, was that a gravitational wave, like the one you saw the picture of, would come through this bar, having come through the Earth, impervious to the Earth, didn't give a damn about the Earth, and excite that bar much like a hammer would. In other words, much like a xylophone. And what he would look for is the ringing of that bar after the gravitational wave went through. Here's another example of it right there. It's got a big vacuum chamber, and in there is another example of one of his bars. The thing that I just want to repeat what Kip said, because that's really why I'm here, to honor that memory. And the memory is really derived from just what you said, Kip. Einstein, in his 1916 paper, has a lovely little thing at the end of his paper, even though he made a mistake in the paper, as Jim pointed out, that says, look, this will never have a role in physics. It's just much too small. And that effectively buried it as a technical possibility for years and years and years. And then what happened is that little by little, and even though you heard that story about the Weber paper in 36, there was a very important conference in 1957, which was the Chapel Hill Conference, which I don't know if any one of you, were you at the Chapel Hill Conference?
I was, yeah.
Yeah, where it was finally discussed what's the reality of these waves. And people began to believe in them more. They even invented Gedanken experiments to think how the waves might interact and might make heat in a ribbon that they were little beads were mounted on. And so what happened was the courage was really the following. Here's Einstein's thing from 1916. Here's Weber in 1957 with Wheeler together, inventing a method to try to detect these things with a lot more technology than was known by Einstein in 1915. And so what happened is, in fact, that took courage, just as Kip says. And the thing is, now let's go on to the next slide. It turns out that when Weber made his announcement that he had made a discovery, which was an honest statement, in 1969, he published a very important paper. But when you publish a very important paper, like says, I have discovered gravitational waves with these techniques. He had three of these detectors, one in Argonne Laboratory in Chicago, and another two here in Maryland, one near his office, another in a golf course. And he was seeing coincidence events. And that's a very important thing that even now in the detection of gravitational waves by LIGO is absolutely essential, is to look for events that are the same, have the same shape, do the same thing in very distant objects. That's one of the ways you distinguish whether you've seen gravitational waves or not. And Joe did it first. So Joe then did this in 69, and he published this paper, which was really an earth-shaking paper. And that engendered a whole bunch of new people to go into this field. I mean, this is what this slide shows. Right after the announcement, and there's some pictures of them, there were people, I mean, there Europe, United States, there were at least seven or eight groups that all were doing the same experiment. And what happened is that they did not see something right away, but they didn't give up. And so what happened is they made better systems. They used, well, Joe did not cool his bars. He didn't use cryogenics. These people added to this the idea of using cold bars, and they tried to see, and this, by the way, is still going on now. And these are different kinds of detectors. They're detectors that are not cylinders, but they're spheres, and they are able to detect from all directions. And there's still hope that one will eventually detect gravitational waves with this kind of a system. So he engendered, by starting the field, and he's given enormous credit for starting the field, that he then started a whole new science, and the science is what we're celebrating today. So I just want people to know that. He was the beginning, okay?
So we've talked a bit about Joe, but there are other faculty members from the University of Maryland who also made an important impact in this field, and some of which you've named. Can you tell the audience what those folks have brought to the field experimentally and theoretically, so the developments that go even beyond?
Let me comment briefly on Richard Isaacson, who will be discussed more later, but the aspect that probably won't be discussed is Richard Isaacson was the person who, as a postdoc of Charlie Misner's.
Grad student
of yours. Right. Yeah. Charlie can discuss this more knowledgeably than I can, but I can attest to its importance looking in from the outside. Working with Charlie, he developed the mathematics of what's called a two-length scale expansion in order to describe the energy and the momentum carried by gravitational waves. And that energy and momentum issue, whether a gravitational wave can carry energy and momentum, was highly controversial before this work that Richard did with you. And after this work, there was no controversy at all. He simply settled once and for all One of the most controversial aspects of general relativity that had been a controversy for decades.
And I'll talk more about Richard when we get to the NSF, which where he played fundamental
role. But I would hope Charlie would comment on Vishu's work on black holes.
Yeah, well, I'd like to, because when I first came to Maryland, I was really on the track of thinking about black holes. I had taught Finkelstein how to think about tumbling light cones in a different connection, and he used that idea to discover that the standard Schwarzschild solution, which originally was hoped to be the field around a point mass, was in fact a black hole solution, and there was this horizon, this one-way membrane, he called it, where things could go in but not get back out, including light. So that was the conversion of previously well written about solution of Einstein's equations that turned it into a black hole. Suggestions for it had strongly come previously from Oppenheimer and Schneider 20 years earlier, but this was the one that nailed it down. And so I was using those ideas. Vishu was one of the first to use them. He, with Edelstein, a graduate student who worked equally hard and worked on an important paper with Vishu, straightening out all these questions of what's possible if you had a black hole, and it got rattled. Well, one always worries about singular cases, absolutely perfect cases. Like, nothing, it doesn't violate the laws of physics to have a pencil stand on its point. But if you let go of it, something will knock it off. The question was open. If you had this perfectly spherical piece of curved space-time, would some jiggle cause it to just disappear into nothing? And Vishveshvara was able to prove no. It is quite stable. If you only give it a slight jiggle, it'll bounce right back. It will ignore it. A few years later, after he'd finished his degree, he wrote a further paper saying, well, if you had this thing, is there any way you could see it? And he said, well, since he only was working with gravitational waves, he said, if I throw a gravitational wave at a black hole, what will happen? And he found out that if the wave has a big wavelength, it won't notice the black hole. If it has a tiny wavelength, it just looks like a particle of light. Either it falls in or it misses. But at the borderline case, it will set the black hole ringing so that it digests the energy of the wave in a few cycles. And that's important and shows up in the data that the experiments have just observed. So sure. That was very important. Yeah. And Isaacson doing the work we just heard about of making sure you could handle gravitational waves in the old conventional way of just describing amplitudes, energy content, frequency, wavelength, speed of light, etc. So those were two of the important people. Matchner was also a student here at that time, and he was looking at all these things. When I went off a few years later on an invited visit to Cambridge, Matchner was an active student, and following Wheeler's advice, I took one of my good students with me, and he got started there, and he's done very important work. 10 years ago, he was the first person to lead a group of people to describe two black holes merging, but then the computers couldn't handle the case of them dancing around. They were just straight on into each other, didn't produce many gravitational waves, because most of the gravitational waves generated by one just went down inside the other. So it was very disappointing for a source of gravity waves, but it was a very big step in the progress of getting computers to be able to handle Einstein's equations.
So when laser interferometers were proposed in the 70s, it seemed to overcome some of the challenges encountered by the resonant bar detectors. But not everyone believed it would be the Holy Grail. Is that correct?
Well, I think we should tell you a story, Kip.
Ray and I have a little thing going here. So in 1973, John Wheeler and Charlie Misner and I published a book, a textbook on relativity called Gravitation. And in that book, I think much probably to Charlie's chagrin as well as mine, there is a brief sentence that mentions searching for gravitational waves with laser interferometers, with the kind of gravity wave detector that that Ray Weiss pioneered. And it says, this is not very promising. And I then went on and spent 60% of the remainder of my career trying to help Ray make it succeed. So it is just one of many examples of how wrong a physicist can be, how often you have to eat crow. I became convinced only by long conversations with Ray, with Joe Weber about his experiment.
And Vladimir
Braginsky in Moscow. I became convinced by the mid-1970s that this field was likely to succeed, and I then voted with my feet and started an experimental group at Caltech to get into the field. But it was only after having been skeptical. The reason for the skepticism is easy to understand. Ray was proposing to look for gravitational waves by monitoring the motion of two big mirrors a few kilometers apart, when the motion was 1/1 trillionth the wavelength of the light that he was going to use to measure that motion. And we'll that's that. Just incredible. It's obviously stupid.
So I have to mention that I agreed with you, Kip. I was, in the late 80s, I was actually NSF, and Rick Isaacson, someone we've mentioned here, pulled me into his office and said, we've got proposals to build these things. What do you think about it? I looked at it. I said, these people are crazy. So, I mean, there was a group of us who thought that Ray and people like that had, this was the 60s and 70s, so we'll stop it there. Ray, can you provide...
Yeah. All right. I'm going to give you a little bit of technical. This has all been prearranged somewhat, but...
go ahead.
But it's okay.
So, it's all true.
I'm going to try to explain to you how a gravitational wave looks first, and that'll be how it behaves so that you can actually detect it. And that's going to be the first slide. So let's look at this next slide. And what you're seeing here is a wave that's coming either out at you or going into the screen, and you happen to be at that red square right in the middle, right there. That's you. You're standing right there. And these are dots. Think of these as masses that have been laid out in space. And what they're doing is you'll notice an interesting motion that's going on here. The dots that are, let's say, the dots are moving away from each other here, for example, or there and there, but the other dots are moving toward each other. In other words, there's both a compression of space as well as an expansion of space going on. And that's all in perpendicular to the motion in which the gravitational wave is moving. And there's one very important property, and this is the one that gives you the basis for the detection in this picture. This happens to be, if you look at these two spots, let's say where I have my green light, those two, they don't move very much. But they're not very separate. They're not separated by much either. Then you look at these two guys, way out there, this guy and way over here. They're moving a lot. And so they have a much bigger separation. And the thing that is a property of the wave is that the amount of motion of those dots is proportional to their separation. So in other words, in mathematical language, the change in separation between the dots divided by their separation before this motion starts. That change divided by the separation itself is a constant in this picture at any one moment. And that's called the strain, and most engineers know what a strain is. You can do a strain with a rubber band. If you want to explain it to one of your kids, just take a rubber band and make marks on the rubber band every quarter of an inch when the rubber band is not stretched yet, and then stretch it. And you'll notice that the stretching is large where your fingers are, but not very large in the middle. And that's a motion of constant strain as you wiggle the rubber band back and forth. It's the same thing going on here. So now when you envision a detector that's going to make a detection of the gravitational waves, you don't want to make a thing that's small because it isn't going to move very much. You want to make something that's pretty big. And here is the advantage that these interferometers have over the kind of acoustic detector that Joe pioneered. There's nothing wrong with what Joe Weber did. It's just a different way of doing it, which has, in some regards, an easier time of making a measurement. because here you're dealing where you can make something so big that it's connected by the velocity of light. For example, you can send light, and that's the idea of what happens in LIGO, and we'll get to that in the next pictures, that you can send light from one dot to the other and measure the time it takes light to go from one to the other. That's what you're going to see in a minute. And the amount of time that it takes will be dependent on whether there's a gravitational wave there or not. And that gets to be an easier and easier measurement to make as you make the system bigger and bigger. That's really the fundamental idea behind LIGO. And also, you could only make acoustic bars as big as the velocity of sound. And that gives you a ratio of about 100,000. Velocity light is 100,000 times faster than is the velocity of sound in most materials. So you can make a much bigger system to measure the gravitational waves. That's really quite fundamental to why these things succeeded. And so let me go on to the next slides. And what it is, and please don't start it yet. What is this? This is a simple demonstration, an animation, to show you the basic idea of how LIGO works. Here is a laser that's putting out light. Here is a beam splitter, which is a device that splits the light so that half of it goes through and it goes to this mirror and then comes back again. The other half of the light gets reflected by that half mirror and goes to this mirror and gets reflected and comes back. And at this moment, these things are arranged in such a way that the time it takes light to go from this beam splitter to this distant mass and back is exactly the same as the time going from the beam splitter here to that distant mass there. Imagine those mirrors, those distant mirrors, are just those very distant dots I showed you in the picture of the gravitational wave. That's one way to think about it. Now, let's see what happens as you start moving things. Let's turn the animation on. And so first, wherever you see red is where there's light. Right now it's arranged, there's no light, except when you start wiggling these masses. And we'll now show you what's going on. When you set this up as a detector, what you want to do, and these are the electric fields, these are the waves that are inside the light, and you see them hitting these distant mirrors. They're coming back from the mirrors, and then you'll see the same thing going on in this arm. Same thing happens. And here there is no light. There's no red markings. And the light has canceled because the two waves just cancel each other at the detector. That's the way you set the trap for the gravitational wave. Now you start wiggling the two mirrors, one in one direction, the other one to shrink, one to expand. And you'll notice that light does appear at the photodetector when the two waves don't cancel each other anymore. And they don't cancel each other anymore because the time it takes light to go those two distances is no longer the same when you stretch one arm and shrink the other. And that is the whole basis of LIGO. So let's go on. Gravitational wave makes light appear at a photodetector. And what's now in the Earth and what made the detection that you saw before are the two detectors in the United States, but they're not the only two detectors in the world. Here's LIGO Hanford, and here's LIGO Livingston. The thing that you saw actually came from the southern sky, hit Livingston first, and about 7 milliseconds, 7,000th of a second later, that same thing hit Hanford. And that told us a little bit about where the gravitational wave was coming from. It's coming from the southern sky someplace, and it goes through the Earth. It doesn't give a damn about the Earth. It hits these things, it keeps on moving, and it just a little bit later, by almost the velocity of light, we could almost say it's going at the velocity of light, it hits Hanford. And now there are other detectors, and we were not able very well to determine where the source on the sky was. That lovely waveform that Charlie showed you, we were not able to tell you on the sky where they came from very well. All we could tell is it's about in the south. And to give that kind of instruction to an astronomer who has a very careful telescope and wants to find out exactly if you have a thing, well, look in the south someplace, you know, that doesn't help. And Peter will tell you a lot more about that in a minute. But on the other hand, there are other detectors, and one of them that is, we would have been with us had they been ready, is a detector in Italy. And that's a French-Italian collaboration called Virgo. They have operated with us before. They were rebuilding their detector just as we were, but they weren't quite ready yet. There's another detector in Germany. Again, these are all interferometers. It's only 600 meters long, and it's a test instrument. It's not really sensitive enough because it's not long enough to see these waves coming from the black holes. And two things are being planned. One is a detector in Japan called Kagra, which is going to be built into the Kamioka mine there. And that's going to be ready, we hope, by 2019, maybe 2020. And then there is a longer-term plan, which is to take a LIGO detector and put it in India. That's sort of 2024, something like that. And why is all of these detectors? They're all essential. And they're essential to be able to do what Peter will describe to you better, namely to be able to tell an astronomer exactly where to look, because then you have many different timing differences, okay? So let me quickly take you on a tour of LIGO. This is just a quickie, it's a little thing so you can get it. Here's LIGO in Louisiana, there's woods. Here's LIGO up in Washington, it's sort of sandy. And here's the beam tube inside of a culvert. There's the end mass, and this is now in Louisiana. Here's what that beam tube looks like. It has a very good vacuum in it. That's the thing that made LIGO expensive. Here's somebody working on a laser table, just like the ones you have in the basement of the physics building here. And here is the control room of the LIGOs at Livingston. And here are people learning how to run the detector. So that's a quick view of LIGO.
So Kip, in the 1970s and early 80s, when foundations for LIGO were being laid, what was the vision of sources that LIGO would actually see and the science LIGO would do with those waves? And how does that compare to today's experience?
Well, I think a benchmark in understanding sources was a conference we had at Battelle Institute in Seattle in 1978. And at that conference, there was a discussion of the sources of gravitational waves that LIGO or Weber bars might detect. And the focus was precisely the same set of sources as we talk about today, the dominant sources. Supernovae, I'll return to this momentarily, neutron, black holes going around each other, colliding and merging, neutron stars going around each other, colliding and merging, black holes tearing neutron stars apart. But in 1978, and in 1978, we looked as a community at all those sources, and we estimated how strong the strongest waves bathing the Earth were likely to be. We came up with a number for the strain, the fractional change in length of an arm in LIGO. The number was 10 to the minus 21. The gravitational wave that was discovered a year ago, the strength of that wave was 10 to the minus 21. Yeah. It was really remarkable that already in 1978, our best guess was right on the mark, within a few tenths of percent, basically. However, in 1978, we thought that it was most likely that the first thing we would see would be a supernova explosion, and we were dead wrong. And we were dead wrong because in the early 1970s, when we began thinking about this, the physics of the so-called weak interaction, which governs the coupling of particles called neutrinos to electrons, that was wrong. It got straightened out in the 1970s, but the effect on simulations was not fully understood until about the time of this conference. And when it was fully understood, suddenly supernovae became a lousy source of gravitational waves, one that we really want to see because it'll teach us about these phenomena, but a lousy source. And so by the early 1980s, we were talking about black hole binaries, neutron star binaries, black holes tearing neutron stars apart. And, well, we just saw the black hole binaries.
Yep. Peter, you joined LIGO in 1999, fresh out of grad school.
Yes.
What attracted you to the project, and what was it like to join it at that stage?
Okay, so I was doing my graduate work in particle physics. I worked on a project at Fermi Lab, and my advisor, late Bruce Weinstein, had a lot of interest. And he was also thinking about what his next sabbatical would be, and one of the things he was looking at was to go work on LIGO. So anyway, he said, you know, Peter, maybe you want to look at LIGO for what to do next. And then one evening, I was working in the computer lab, and he called up and said, Kip Thorne's going to be at my house tomorrow. Why don't you come over and talk with him? And so this would be, this was 1998, I think.
I was married to Bruce's sister.
Yes, there's a reason.
This was sort of a family thing.
Yeah. And so I did. It was a Saturday. I went and talked with Kip for about, I don't know, maybe an hour and a half, 2 hours. I was kind of fascinated with the technology. My background was as an experimental physicist. I like to get my hands on things. I don't get to do that so much anymore. But that was just really interesting. And, you know, I was starting to think about what I would do after I got my degree, and I could have gone on in particle physics, but this seemed like just a cutting-edge field. And then, Ray, you came and gave a colloquium maybe a month later or something, around that time, same time, and I got to sit and talk with you about it, too. And I think that between the three of you...
I didn't talk you out of it?
You didn't talk me out of it, no. I think among the three of you, you know, I just had the feeling that, wow, this is something, this is really... something special that I could go be part of. So I went to Caltech. I was able to join the group there with a fellowship, and it was a really interesting time because it was right when the project had been funded. You know, the challenges of getting funding were a thing of the past at that point, more or less. And there was already a good team. I think a lot of the people who came from your group at MIT. We're the core of just making this all work, and a lot of them are still working on the project now. It's really amazing. But then there was this influx of people coming from all different disciplines. I was coming from particle physics, several other people who had also had experience analyzing big data sets. So there was just kind of this flow of people who were all interested in the amazing science that could be done and kind of bringing different talents in. So it was really a good time. And a lot of us, you know, I didn't know much about lasers and optics and so on, but it didn't matter. I learned as I went along. You know, there was people would share information.
Sure.
Yeah, but you made a lot of contributions to that very quickly.
I had a lot of fun. Yeah. I got put to work. I went up to LIGO Hanford, and the first thing they did was said, you know, here's a wrench. It was like this big. And take those bolts off of that chamber over there.
So Kip.
Well, you know what a wrench looked like. That's a.
Yes.
So Kip. Numerical simulations of colliding black holes have turned out to be important for LIGO's discoveries. How did those simulations come to be?
I think the first person to really push on the idea of simulating black holes coming together was John Wheeler, back in the era when you were his student, around 1957. John had a vision that we should study how warp space-time, how the warping of space-time behaves in what I would call a storm, when it's highly excited like the ocean in a giant storm. And it was obvious you couldn't answer that question by solving Einstein's equations with pencil and paper because we just weren't clever enough in that situation to solve them. The only possibility was to do it numerically. And so the pioneering work was done actually by you and people around you in the 50s.
Right, there was some small amount that was actually done on computers then from Wheeler's group, but the other thing he did was he believed in computers. He told us that, well, the computers aren't very powerful, but imagine they were. Set your problem up in such a way that a computer could understand it. By the time you've defined the problem that well, you can probably solve it yourself. but I did continue to worry about how to formulate Einstein's equations. When I went to Cambridge in 57, my whole notebook for the first 100 pages is all about learning finite difference methods to use for turning computers into solving equations like Einstein's. So there was a lot of that going on. And there were a couple of Wheeler students who managed to get IBM, Lindquist, and I'm not sure who else, let them use a computer to give a try at it. In those very early days, but it kept recurring all the time, and some of Wheeler's tie-ins, such as to Bryce DeWitt and others from Los Alamos, led to computers always being waiting in the background to be properly used in these problems.
But today, from that time until today, the mathematical formulation of Einstein's equations, the way they are written down, that you, Arnouet, and Deser formulated in the 1950s is the formulation that has been used continually since then.
Yeah, that was a way of translating Einstein's equations into a way that physicists were familiar with from electromagnetism.
Sure. And that a computer could understand.
Right. Yeah.
And I think that's when you came up with the Laplace and shift functions.
That's right.
Some of us
actually
learned in our childhood. In kindergarten, in fact.
But the numerical relativity then became an effort that went on in parallel with the experiment. And it was clear to me, at least, and I think probably to a lot of other people, by the by 1980 that in order to understand what we would see with LIGO, that you would have to have simulations.
Yeah.
And so I sat there in the background urging the people who are doing these simulations on to get them done successfully.
Yeah, but there was also a very important part done by people analytically. And I think Alessandra should say something.
Yes, in fact,
Alessandra.
I was going to call on Alessandra. Yeah.
Let me just say that the other thing pushing this for the computers was coming from Isaacson, who we may hear more of, because he was not only funding people like Ray and theorists, but he was pushing for the development of supercomputer centers and things like that, specifically because he knew they would be needed for gravitational waves.
Alessandra, you were next.
Let me just do one more end of this thread and then turn it over to...
Go ahead.
I just wanted to say that then the effort on the simulations was a large effort, an international effort, and a key phase of this was the phase where people were going from doing things head-on to beginning to do things with the black hole spiraling around. And it was Richard Matzner who led the international collaboration in the 1990s that was pushing this forward. The bottom line is that today we have several different groups around the world that can do the simulations that LIGO does need. Right. So
Alessandra, you were trained in particle physics like Peter, I think, initially, and then you switched. So how did you start working on gravitational waves?
Yeah, so there were two important, I think, turning points in my scientific career. So the first one happened in the fall of 1997, when after spending 9 months at CERN, I started a postdoctoral scholarship in France at the Institut des Hautes-Etudes Scientifiques, where is Thibaut Damour. And at the time, in 1997, in fact, there were, LIGO was almost constructed, the two LIGO detectors were almost completed. And it was known at the time that if binary black holes existed, they would have produced the strongest signal for LIGO because they would merge in the most sensitive part of the detector. However, at the time, in 1997, there were not yet simulations in numerical relativity, and we didn't know the signal from the merger. And so I started with Thibaut Damour to tackle the problem using more approximated methods. Then the other important turning point was after the postdoc at IHS, I got an offer for a fellowship at Caltech in Kip's group. And so at that point, I decided that was a great opportunity to be at the core of the field of gravitational waves, where a lot of work in source modeling and astrophysics of sources, data analysis, instrumentation were happening. And so I decided to swerve from cosmology, which I was doing at the time, and dive in this new field. And I think I have no regret for that.
That's wonderful. Wonderful story. So when and how did you decide to tackle the monumental task of developing waveform models, and why is your method so very successful?
Well, first of all, I want to perhaps explain in a few words how we detect signals, gravitational wave signals with LIGO. There is a lot of similarity of analogous problem in which you want to recognize or detect voices in an environment where there is a lot of background noise. So what you do is that you use some, so if you have a knowledge of the voice in advance, you can use them as filters and you can pull out the voices in this very noisy background. And we do the same in LIGO. We use, what we call templates, which are signals, waveforms predicted by the theory of general relativity that we compute, we pre-compute, in fact, and we use template banks to pull out the signal from the noise. Problem is in predicting these signals using solving the Einstein equation is that these equations are very complicated, and as other people and Kip was explaining, the best way to compute this signal is to use numerical relativity. However, it's very time consuming to produce the simulation. Maybe we can see, sorry, can you actually show the? So first of all, I want to say that so the best way of producing signals solving the Einstein equation is to do it with a supercomputer. But it takes a long time to produce a simulation, so it's quite slow, but you would get in this way an exact solution. The other way is to use paper and pencil, which means to use some approximation methods that you use to solve the Einstein equation. So this is fast, but it's approximate. Can you show now the video? So this is a simulation that was produced as part of the SXX project, which was mentioned before, of two black holes going around each other and merging, with the parameters very close to the event that we discovered last year in September. And the simulation lasts, as you can see, for something like 20 orbits. And then this is the last part when the two black holes merge and they form a new black hole and rings down. Now, to produce this simulation, it takes 3 weeks. Now, to have a bank of templates that can be used for the search and to extract parameters once we have a detection, we need something like 100,000 of waveforms, even more. And so we cannot just use numerical relativity. We have to interface these two methods, the approximated one, fast, and the exact one with supercomputers. And so what happened is that when I moved to Maryland, the University of Maryland in 2005, that was a gold year because was the time in which the first simulation of two black holes was done by Franz Pretorius first, and then this was followed by the groups at Goddard, the NASA Center, by John Baker, who is here in the audience, and John Centrella, and then Manuela Campanelli and Lusto group at Rochester, actually Brownsville at the time. So I just arrived here in the fall of 2005, and I started working, trying to use the method that I developed with Thibaut D'Amour to complement or complete, actually, this method using numerical relativity simulations. And then over the years, we improved the model with postdoc students here at Maryland, working with first the group of Baker and Centrella, and then with the group of SXX. And during my last year here, before moving actually to Germany, with some postdoc and students, we work out actually the waveform model that then was used in the first observing run by LIGO. And in fact, in the next slide, you see here the result in black of the waveform produced by the numerical simulation that you saw just a minute ago, and in red, the model. And the fact that they agree very well means that if we now use the model to search, to extract the parameters, we can be sure that we have, extract the parameter correctly without, big systematic errors, et cetera. And in fact, in the next plot, you see now the data of the first event that we discover in gray, and how the reconstructed template, which is represented in cyan, reproduce very well the data. And by doing this, we can then know how big were the black holes, 30, 40 solar masses, how far the source was from the Earth, and where it was located in the sky. All is basically written in this very short signal of just a fraction of a second, by just tracking very accurately the amplitude and the phase. Yes.
I certainly remember 2005 because, as you may recall, I actually contributed money to support you here.
Okay.
So I'll never forget that.
I think you should be happy about that.
I think it was a good investment. So let's see. Peter, suppose, how could you be so sure that LIGO was going to detect these waves? Because no one had ever seen them before.
Right, yeah. Well, in fact, after I decided to go to Caltech for my postdoctoral fellowship, Bruce was having a farewell dinner for me and the other grad students and so on. He said, well, Peter, you may be moving from a difficult experiment to an impossible one. So, okay. So I had, you know, I had some thoughts about whether this was ever going to work, you know, or whether it would work eventually. But really, I became convinced quickly because I got my hands on more than just the bolts and got to understand how things work. But there are really two parts of that. Can these detectors actually record a gravitational wave signal coming through? And this is incredibly small. I mean, we're talking about changing this length by about 10 to the minus 18 meters.
Sure,
the length of this.
Sure. Can I translate that for the audience?
Yeah.
What he was just talking about is 1/1000th the size of the nucleus of a helium atom. That's that number he just gave.
It's really small, and we're using things that are made of atoms, so you wonder how that works, and that's where a lot of the cleverness comes in about using large beam sizes, so we're averaging over atoms of the mirror surface there. There's so many clever tricks built into these detectors that were developed over the years and just make, you know, get another factor of 10, another factor of 100. This is how we get down to the sensitivity. So you believe that it should work, but then there's the reality of actually building it and having electronics that have noise and digital electronics that might have noise. That's all cleverly engineered too. But really to test it, the thing that gave me a lot of confidence is that we could actually put in simulated signals by shaking mirrors just ever so slightly. I mean, at the level, the 10 to the minus 18, 10 to the minus 17 meters. And then find that in the data. So putting in a concrete signal and pulling it out was reassuring. Other than that, we were basically just recording noise. We were the world's experts at detecting nothing for many years. We had the most sensitive detectors that were not recording anything, pretty much. But the other part of it is, suppose that if the detectors really do record the signal that's arriving, how do we know that we're going to recognize it? Now we have the beautiful modeling, and we know now. I mean, we can put the plot up that shows how beautifully it matches, and probably we could expect that would probably work. But we also needed a backup. So we had the template-based analysis that is the premier sensitive, the best analysis. But we also had a generic transient search. So that we could detect anything that was, you know, signal-like, anything that was not just noise. And as it turns out, just kind of a historical accident, that's the algorithm that detected the signal first. And within minutes to an hour, you know, humans were aware of this, and then the news spread within the collaboration. Sure. So we would have detected the signal eventually anyway. But as it turns out, our backup analysis was the one that really alerted us first to this.
Sure. And for the audience, Ray, I have a question for you. LIGO Hanford is located how far from the coastline? Is it?
Yeah. It's like about 150 miles from the Pacific.
150 miles.
Yeah.
LIGO can actually detect the rising and lowering.
Well,
of the tides.
No, the tides are not important. You see the Earth tides. The tides are already pulled in the Earth.
Right.
So I mean, just a bump in the Earth is pulled by the Moon and the Sun.
Yes,
and that already is something like, I'll tell you, it's about a tenth of a millimeter over the length of
the solid Earth. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, so
exactly.
You have to correct that. You take that out by servos.
Yeah. How about the lapping of the waves?
And that
on
has
the ocean.
A nice periodicity that has both a 6-hour period,
sure.
a 12-hour period, a 24-hour period. You know a lot about it.
Well,
and that's not going to screw up the experiment.
Yeah, I know, but that's what convinced me LIGO would work.
Yeah.
Because you see, the first time I went to the LIGO Hanford, I was told about that. I'm like, these people are serious now.
Yeah. Well, it's the first two astronomical objects we detected, the sun and the moon.
That's right.
Yeah, right.
Exactly. That's certainly right. Ray, can you expand on the importance of the Science Foundation? You've alluded to that several times tonight.
Let me quickly say something about that, because no talk on LIGO should ever go without this. I mean, at least in the beginning. What you see in this picture is actually the people who actually made it happen at the National Science Foundation. But you'll notice something. Here's Rich Isaacson, who was trained here, and so is Beverly Berger. And another person, I don't know if he was trained here, but very important person is David Burley. There are others. These all were playing important parts. These are people doing it. Now, I want to talk a little bit about Rich Isaacson and Marcel Barden. And now here's the thing that's so remarkable about this, is you have to go back to what Kip was describing earlier. First, you have to go to the fact that the instruments themselves had to get factors of 10 to the 12. between the most rudimentary thing that you had in the laboratory, you had to make 10 to the 12 improvement in it. That's a million times a million. You'd start with a wavelength, as Kip said, you start with a wavelength of light, and we go down to, that's 10 to the minus 6 meters, you have to get down to 10 to the minus 18 meters. That's a trick, lots of tricks, okay? They were not yet fully developed, those tricks, when people began to talk about this. There's another piece to it. Even though you might have a trick for measuring it, you don't know that the mirrors themselves are stationary enough. In fact, they're not. There's another million times a million there. You're everybody in this hall, maybe not in the fancy new physics building you have. I'm trying to get the data for that, but is wiggling up and down by about 10 to the minus 6 meters. That's just because of noise in the Earth. And so consequently, to get to 10 to the minus 18, you have to isolate the mirrors from the motions of the Earth themselves. So that was the other very hard and difficult thing to do, but it took a long time. And it's just as hard as getting the sensing to that point. Now, let's go back now to the NSF. Here is a technology of which that has to be developed, which looks to many engineers and people who are hard-nosed as very difficult. I mean, when you say 10 to the minus 18 to most people, they look at you like you're a little bit crazy. I mean, you know, you come from another planet. And that was the beginning of it. On top of that, you couldn't tell, and because, well, Kip wasn't yet thinking about it as hard as he did a little bit later, you couldn't tell people, even if you managed to get that, what would you measure? That was the other problem. And in other words, and that was a problem even that Joe Weber had. He was seeing, he didn't know what he was looking at. And even if he had been right, it would have been very difficult to understand what it was. So the thing was, here are the two hurdles. You come to the NSF with a proposal that you wanted to do gravitational wave detection by this interferometric method. You have to still get a 10 to the 12 in sensitivity, and you have to tell them what the sources are. And neither was really solid. Nevertheless, Rich Isaacson, who had been trained here and in the field, took the gamble and then did something really quite remarkable. He then convinced his boss, who is right at the end of this picture, right there, that's Marcel Bardon, who was a nuclear physicist. He came from Columbia. And Rich then started meckering in Marcel's ear, you know, and saying, look, this is great stuff. This is exactly what the NSF should be doing. It has a high risk, but enormous payoff should it work. And he kept at it. He kept at it for years and kept making the case for the science. And then he also, by the way, told us how to operate. We were pretty naive at this. For example, there was a time when Kip, Ron Drever, and I tried to run this project. We screwed up royal, okay? And what happened is that, and Rich told us that pretty quickly. I mean, and he then helped us orchestrate the idea that maybe there should be a single director. And we eventually, all along the way, not only did he have scientific advice, but he had what I would call administrative and what I would call operational advice. And he stuck with it. And he got the NSF to stick with it for almost 45 years. I mean, and then to spend $2 billion on it, okay? Unbelievable. I don't think this could be done anymore. Not with the ground rules that this started at. And I give Rich and then Beverly enormous credit for having pushed this through and kept it going. It's quite a story, I have to say. I wouldn't have expected this at NASA. I wouldn't have expected in today's NSF, I don't think you can get a thing like this. You needed advocacy at the highest levels, and it was done with intelligence. And that's what I think Rich really provided for us. He's a real hero.
So what's next for the field? What new research questions have the gravitational waves detection raised for you all and for the field as a whole? And what excites you most about the future of gravitational astronomy?
Why don't you talk about multi-messenger astronomy?
Sure. Well, okay, so now we know things happen out there, and they're sending gravitational waves our way, and we're going to catch more of them, right? So what are we going to catch? Is it all going to be binary black holes? Are we going to start seeing those neutron stars? And you know, what some of us, including me, are really interested in is how else can we see these events? So I'm part of an effort to work with astronomers to try to catch the other signatures that may be arriving from these incredibly energetic events. So we're looking for gamma rays, we're looking for x-rays, we're looking for radio pulses, we're looking for optical afterglows showing that there was an expanding fireball or something like that. We really don't know exactly what we're going to find yet, so we're just trying to cover all the bases. And hopefully next year or this year or in a few years, we'll start to see these things in other ways.
Well, wow. That's all I can say, just wow.
Well, let's say it another way. I mean, I think we made good on part of the promise. I mean, we've started a field that you could call gravitational wave astronomy. That's our contribution to the multi-messenger things. And I think that is probably the most significant thing that we've done in terms of, and I don't mean to be self-proud of this thing, but it is this thing that is going to change the face of the way we look at the universe. It's inevitable. If it doesn't, it'd be most surprising. I mean, I think that's really...
But there's also just testing the theory. The beautiful match of those curves is just breathtaking.
Yeah. So, but it's the theory, we'll see. Absolutely right. It's still physics, but it's a mixture of physics with astrophysics.
Definitely a mixture.
It's a wonderful mixture.
I think Kip wants to say something.
But I think on the experimental side, which the two of you are deeply involved in, the LIGO sensitivity is going to improve factor of 3 to get to design sensitivity.
Yeah.
That means you see 3 times farther into the universe. Since our universe has 3 space dimensions, that means you see 3 times 3 times 3 times bigger volume. So presumably, 3 times 3 times 3 are about 30 times more frequent events and new things. There are on the drawing boards tentative plans for a upgrade following that might reach fruition in the late 2020s, that could pick up another factor of 3 or 4 in distance, so another factor of 30 or 50 in the event rate. There are on the drawing boards tentative plans in the 2030s, perhaps, for increasing the arm length, new facility with 40-kilometer arms instead of 4-kilometer arms, another huge increase. It's like what we've seen in other areas of astronomy. Radio astronomy, X-ray astronomy, as the time passed, what began as a first tentative detections created a huge plethora of discoveries because of improvements. That's happening here. Beyond that, LIGO's looking for gravitational waves in one frequency band with periods of milliseconds. There are 3 other frequency bands that will be opened over the next 20 years. Like analogs of radio astronomy, X-ray astronomy, infrared astronomy, it's as though all of those forms of astronomy had been opened up with electromagnetic waves within 20 years. This is going to happen in 20 years. And we'll be seeing a huge range of other things. But it seems to me the most interesting thing that will be going on maybe 20 years from now, surely 30 years from now, a central theme is going to be exploring the first 1 second of the life of the universe, because this is the only form of radiation that propagated, that had the capability to propagate from the earliest moments of the universe through the extremely hot, dense matter in that first 1 second to come to us unscathed. And so that's what I think is going to be the most exciting piece of this in the coming decades.
Yeah. Let me elaborate for a moment on what Kip just said. There's many more projects than what's on the ground. And I think let me just say what they are so people know. I mean, there is a program to look at gravitational wave periods from hours to fractions, to minutes, okay? That's called LISA, the Laser Interferometer Space Antenna. It's a project that's almost been as long in gestation as LIGO has. It was originated in 1975 about. And the thing is, that is a thing to do it in space. It's an idea that Goddard was working on, JPL has been working on, the Europeans have been working on. And I hope that in the next few years, the Americans, who were very strong into that, will be back in it strongly. And that was a thing that they got out of it because of the troubles with James Webb. There was not enough money to do it. But now there's I think partly because of our discovery, but also because people recognize that this is a good thing to do. The United States may get back into that as
Lisa
a significant partner, I hope.
I was just talking with John Baker, who's a Goddard,
he's here,
just
right.
Before we came on. Yeah. And he was telling me about how they are ramping up at Goddard now.
Yeah, they should ramp up because, I mean, the recommendation they got from a fairly good committee demanded that, sort of suggest that. Yeah. But that's not the end. That's a very important mission that has its own science, and it actually will see LIGO sources before LIGO season. It'll be a very, you know, it'll be something that's synergistic in a beautiful way. But it has its own sources. Then there is this idea that has been running for probably 10 years to look at many different millisecond pulsars with radio astronomy and watching them with radio telescopes, and their periods, the periods of these millisecond pulsars, will change if there are gravitational waves that go between us and the millisecond pulsar. And what happens is there you have the possibility of seeing things with periods of years to maybe fractions of a year. And that's a very interesting area for the early history of the universe.
Sure.
Not the primeval. The primeval thing has its own dedicated thing right now,
sure.
In fact, which was the cosmic background radiation. Sure. I don't know, Jim, you want to talk about that? Or?
I am indeed. In fact, I wanted to, when you talk about millisecond pulsars, I think it's very important for people to know that they're already, that people are already expanding beyond LIGO science, thinking about the Hellings-Down effect, which is what you just described in terms of these millisecond pulsars as a way to detect the gravity waves as they pass between us. So this is opening up an enormous one. Could I have the last transparency? It's a still, this, which Kip alluded to in his comment, to me is the ultimate part of why these folks have, you should really think of them as champions of science, because what they have done is essentially the same that Galileo did when he first took a telescope and pointed it up at the sky and saw the satellites of Jupiter and the rings of Saturn. We're looking at the modern version of Galileo in this collaboration here. Now, in his time, of course, a single person could do this. Now it takes networks and decades of incredible hard work. If you took a telescope right now, the most powerful telescope, this is the best that you can do in terms of seeing. This thing called the cosmic microwave background is a signal. I like to say that our universe took a baby picture of itself when it was 380,000 years old, because that's what this represents, is a baby picture of our universe. And it turns out that you can, if using light, you can never see beyond that. That's the earliest thing you can see, is at 380,000 years after the Big Bang. What these folks have opened up here with this new technology is a way to hear behind this. And just like sonograms can be used to take sounds and convert them into images, the LIGO descendants will be listening to our universe all the way back to the first second. And because we know how to take sound and turn those into pictures, we will be looking behind this curtain. So this is a pretty big reason to celebrate. And I cannot thank our panel enough for this wonderful discussion. We've gone a little bit long because I let the panel go because I wanted to get all this information out. But I think we have a few minutes, and we would like to open the floor for questions. But before we do, please, let's show our applause for this wonderful dedication. Okay, so we have microphones, and if you have a question, we would ask you to proceed to the microphones.
Okay. I just wanted to ask you if you had sample power spectra of the noise background which you're working against. Because the signals ultimately are signal versus noise. So as an electrical engineer, that's the first thing I think of.
Yes.
As opposed, in some sense, your detections are based on sort of like a multi-channel detector system, but so you just took power spectrum and looked for peaks in that. Did you see anything?
Yeah, I'm trying to, should I try? I
think yeah, go ahead, Ray.
Look, there are two things you saw. You're talking about the thing that is the black hole detection, right?
No, I think he's talking about the noise power spectrum.
But noise power spectrum, that's the one that is, the one you heard which is in the frequency spectrum of the
I thought he was talking about the instrumental noise level. Was it that or about the signal
properties? I'd say the background noise.
Yeah, well, okay. What makes the background noise? Is that the question?
And what does the spectrum look like?
Yeah. Well, that's a complicated question, but what happened is that what you saw today as the both in the spectrum, which was that chirp, which is a frequency spectrum versus time, and the other one, which is a waveform, amplitude of H, amplitude of strain versus time. Both of those things are standing up, you can see them against the noise. What you heard was, for example, let's take the frequency spectrum. You heard that hish like that, that's the background noise of the instrument. The thing that goes whoop like that, that's the signal. And that's very easy to distinguish.
So the signal noise ratio in the first detection was 24.
Yeah.
That's
and 24
good.
Is so huge
that's a big one.
That in discussing it, we don't generally talk about the noise. However, there are other signals. There was the second signal, which we didn't discuss, that came in October, was down at a signal noise ratio where you only have an 87% probability that it's real. So a lot of attention is paid to the noise spectrum in discussing and analyzing that. But the reason we didn't discuss it was that it's enormous signal-to-noise ratio in that signal.
Let me just say one more thing for you. I mean, the two methods that were talked about for the signal analysis, which Alessandra talked about, that first signal you saw is actually a raw signal, mind you. That's what people could see on an oscilloscope at the sites. All that was needed was to do the same thing you do on your audio set at home when you have some low-frequency noise, you turn the bass down. You don't have as much bass. And a little bit of treble was reduced. That's all the filtering that was done, to see those signals. Now, when you do this much more elegant system, which is to by the way, that was seen by cross-correlating the two detectors, the Hanford detector and the Louisiana detector, cross-correlating, finding the maximum in the cross-correlation product. On the other hand, what Alessandra was talking about is where you have a very clean waveform. You have many, many, many of them. And you then look at that and cross-correlate your detector, which is noise plus signal, against that waveform. That's a much more sensitive way to look for the signal. And that's how we found the thing that Kiptus is talking about. We have a second signal that has a very high signal to noise.
Yes. So this
cross-correlation.
Since we are a little bit short of time, so I'm going to end this discussion. We will be taking questions alternating. There's a young man standing up over here. He's next.
Firstly, I just want to thank you guys again for taking the time to talk to us about this. The main thing I was wondering is that the first event that you guys detected was initially two black holes coming together. But if these waves exhibit other properties like other waves, like they can superimpose and you can have constructive interference, how do you know that it's coming from two black holes and not a multitude of other events that have, you know, over the course of the universe have managed to constructively interfere and look like what you've got?
Why don't you answer that, Alessandra?
Well, I think by comparing, the signal that we observed with the solution from the Einstein equation of two black holes in spiraling and merging, we found the best agreement that we had. So it's the most plausible explanation of what we have seen. And we have, of course, an error bar that is set by our signal-to-noise ratio. Also, if you are thinking about having superposition of many events, we have not seen this. I mean, we would have continued to see maybe many more events, but we have seen only two until now. And so the idea that this could be, there could be a huge superposition of signals is very unlikely.
Also, each of the events is the signal in the two detectors is consistent from coming from a direction.
Yes.
We can't tell exactly what direction it is, but it's not like it's coming from all directions. It's coming from a direction.
Okay, thank you.
There's someone over here, I believe.
Hi, thank you very much. I'd like to ask Kip about the movie Interstellar.
Okay.
Did we see any gravitational waves in the movie? If not, can you explain the physics of what happens when the spaceship went into the black hole?
So let me start. let me start it's with the response. I actually did see the movie, and I couldn't get past the launch. I don't know if any of you folks noticed it, but the interstellar spaceship was a ring with a sort of a rod in between and a connection point with a single connection point. I don't know any mechanical engineer would send a ship up looking like that. I mean, seriously, go back and look at the movie. It's just amazing to me that they fail at simple engineering. So therefore, since I'm a physicist and I sat through that, when they got to the science, I had, let's just say, less than complete confidence that they would get it all right. Although I do know Kip was involved with that, so let me turn this over to him.
Okay, so let me just say that this demonstrates why Ray is the experimenter and I'm the theorist.
So I think that's probably the only commentary we have.
Yeah, no. I think we should focus on gravitational waves, but let me say one thing about gravitational waves in interstellar.
Okay.
So in the original treatment for interstellar, which I co-authored, from which it sprang, it included a prologue in which LIGO detects gravitational waves. Christopher Nolan removed that prologue in his final draft of the screenplay. And I agreed with him because gravitational waves were not used elsewhere in the movie. However, 3 days after we announced the discovery, Chris telephoned me and said, "Would you come over to the studio? I'd like to talk about gravity waves." So I came over and I sat down, and he then talked for about 20 minutes about how he could have incorporated gravity waves in the movie and how he sort of regretted not having done it. And then he said, "But that's the past. We have to look to the future." And so then we discussed the future.
Sure.
So there's the connection of gravity waves to interstellar.
Yes, well, as I said, I did know about your involvement. Yeah. But like I said, I couldn't get past the mechanical engineering. I'm sorry. I think we're over here next.
Okay, my question is about how does gravitational waves correlate with the concept of gravitons? Do they work together, or is gravitons a whole new field for research?
Charlie.
Well, we think that it's the same relationship as between radio waves and photons, particles of light. For radio waves, you mostly don't need them. But I did find one situation when I was trying to say, could I produce them? And I said, what's the simplest generator of gravitational waves? It's changing quadrupole moment. So I go to the workout room, grab a couple weights, and start doing exercises. That's a changing quadrupole moment. And then I did the calculation, how much gravitational waves would be emitted. And the answer came out that if you continued 24 hours a day, on the average, once every year and a half, you will get one graviton.
let me just say that, respond also just to note that Charlie said it exactly right. Gravitons are to gravity as photons are to electromagnetic signals. And the important thing to note is that we discovered photons when we discovered that energy in light comes in packets. That's the actual quantization. So when we have an experiment where we can actually see the discrete energy spectrum from gravitons, then we will know that they're not just in Star Trek, they're part of our universe.
Thank you.
Over here?
Yeah, hi. I think we're pretty familiar, and you know, we understand the excitement of a experimental detection and surprise. Alessandra or Kip, could you tell us anything about theoretical surprises and discoveries that were made along the way that you didn't expect?
So, I mentioned at the beginning that early on, John Wheeler's challenge to us to understand geometrodynamics, by which he meant the highly nonlinear dynamics of warp space-time, how warp space-time behaves in a storm. In this first source that we saw, which is caused by two black holes spiraling together and colliding, if you go back then and look at the numerical simulations that correspond to that particular event, you can make movies from those numerical simulations, and you can see the warped space-time, how it behaved in a storm. And maybe if you can get back to that video, I'll just show it quickly. But if you can't, then that's okay. But the point I want to get at is directly connected with this was that the simulations have begun to teach us how time behaves when it is speeding up and slowing down wildly, how space behaves when its shape is undulating like giant waves in a storm. We've seen the gravitational waves from that. The gravitational waves were emitted by huge oscillations in the shape of space and the rate of flow of time. And that's what caused the waves to be so strong. And the remarkable thing was that the total energy that was carried off in the gravitational waves was what you would get by annihilating three suns and turning it all into gravitational waves. And that came off in a period that was so short, a small fraction of a second, that the power, the energy that came off per unit time, was 50 times higher than the total power in light that comes from all the stars in the universe put together.
So
50 universe luminosities. And so that for me, these are examples of the gravity wave related discoveries and understandings that the theory side of things connected with this.
So let me observe that if we're going to try to get in a few more questions, we're going to have to both speed up the questions and ask for shorter responses the audience.
Yes, sir.
So next.
Okay. This is going to be a bit of a more mundane question, and that is, what went into...
That's okay, as long as it's short.
Yeah. What went into the site selection for the detector, where you were going to put them, and how the logistics were going to be on that?
Wow.
Right.
You want to know how the sites were selected? Yeah. It was a mixture of requirements that we laid on what we needed. I mean, they had to be accessible. They had to be moderately quiet. And they had to be separated by at least 3,000 kilometers. And then there was a list of states in the United States that wanted to have LIGO in them. In other words, there was a solicitation done by the project, writing letters to all the state governors of all 50 states. Would they want to bid on having this in their state? Then there was committees that looked at that. They made pairings that satisfied those requirements. And some four pairings or five pairings were given to the NSF, and they made the final decision of which then had to do with some politics as well. So it wasn't, you know, it's always a complicated process. That's the best I can tell you right now. There was politics involved, but it wasn't the worst kind of politics you can think of. Okay.
I believe we're now moving to a questioner from our left, please.
So my question is, how often should you expect to get measurements? Or record signals. Detecting. How often should you expect to detect anything?
Well,
so in the first search, which lasted for 4 months, the two detectors were both up and running simultaneously and in good condition half the time. So you had 2 months worth of data. Two strong signals were seen. So that was about once per month. When we reached design sensitivity, when the experimenters reached design sensitivity, the volume of the universe we will see is, as I said, about 30 times bigger. So you should, by that extrapolation, see once per day. However, when you're basing it on two events, the statistics are really uncertain. Yeah. Imagine polling on the presidential race. By sampling two people. So this extrapolation of say once a day is highly uncertain, but it will be high. Let's just put it that way. It'll be high.
Do we do that sampling in front of Trump Tower? Okay, I'm afraid we are really running short, so it's got to be short.
So do gravitational waves do they affect the passage of time over the area that it passes, and if so, is
passage
that measurable?
Of, passage of time.
Do they affect the passage of time?
The question is asked, do gravitational waves pass through the vicinity of space, do they affect the
rate of flow of time?
Yeah. Oh. Yeah, I'd say, especially in this storm, you see, they are doing that. As we watched light from the Milky Way try to come past there, some of it got there ahead of time, some others. So built into that whole computation that the computer did using Einstein's equations, different time shifts had to be imposed on the different rays of light coming in. So it was affecting both time and space in producing that distorted image of the distant Milky Way.
And I fear that we're all going to turn into pumpkins now, and that I'm going to I'm sorry, I see one man. Go ahead.
I have a question. I wanted to ask if the curvature of the space surrounding the Earth due to gravity would act as a lens for extraterrestrial gravity waves, and if so, could this be used to improve your ability to detect these waves?
Well, gravitational waves would be lensed, I mean, by the curved space-time around any massive body. So yes. Now, could it be useful? Well, not really, not directly. Well, not the Earth's curvature. Now, we have talked about whether distant gravitational waves could be lensed by galaxy clusters so that we would be able to detect them farther away than we otherwise would be able to. And yes, if the circumstances were just right, that could help us.
And I fear that, having relented on that one, that it is now time for us to call this to a close. My dean had been giving me the evil eye for a couple of minutes now, so I'm going to call Dean Banavar to close our proceedings.
What a wonderful evening this has been. Please join me in thanking our distinguished panelists for providing... for providing such interesting stories and insights into the field of gravitational waves. With two events detected and more expected in the future, I know we are all looking forward to this bold new age of gravitational astronomy. And as new discoveries are made, we will always remember that the quest to detect gravitational waves began right here on this campus, and that the field was forever changed by contributions from scientists at the University of Maryland. Thank you all again for coming tonight.